The issue of school safety is a major concern, from the local administrative level to the parents of the students and even societal perceptions of law and order, which are linked to the security of educational institutes. Unsafe educational institutions contribute to cases of school truancy and overall weakening of the human resource development. According to one study, keeping children away from schools has cost India an annual loss of 0.30% of its GDP, which is worth $6.79 billion. While most often reported incidents of abuse in schools are directed towards the children, there have also been cases of juvenile violence being targeted at the school staff themselves. In addition, millennial threats such as cyberbullying and peer pressure stress levels all contribute to additional safety concerns for educational establishments.
As far as structural procedures are concerned, one ensures that the safety and security measures of the building are in place. There are CCTVs, cameras around. The fences are fortified. There is no place by which a child can fall in. There are no open drains. At every floor, there are women who are sort of moving up and down to ensure that there's no bullying going on. There are excess auxiliary staff in place. But you know, this really doesn't work, because a CCTV only comes into place when a problem has taken place. You know, one doesn't have people watching the camera 24/7. After all, it's not a jail. And it's not a bank, so that, you know, you're not expecting a heist or a robbery. There are 3,000 children in a space of different ages. And so, you know, you're not perpetually doing that. So I think the most important thing that we are doing, and which we have been doing as progressive schools, is creating processes where children are understanding the whole idea of compassion, of connectivity, of collaboration, of creating counselors, of creating peer buddies, so that if there is a situation, an emotional situation in a child, you're able to preempt it.
In light of the societal impact and the changes which the educational institutions need to bring in to reform their existing security and safety norms, India Risk Report looks at the vulnerabilities which the system faces and how to address these challenges.
Hello and welcome to another episode of India Risk Report. And in this episode, we are looking at safety and security of educational institutions, primarily schools in India, but more importantly also the whole gamut of educational institutions that have now become very much part of our social fabric. And in India, we are seeing figures that there is a feeling that something like 46% of the parents whose children go to schools and educational institutions have cited lack of adequate safety and security measures as an area of concern for them. So we are going to focus on that, and we have two experts with us who are going to look at not just as security, but we have a hands-on player there. We have Captain Gurmeet Kaur, ex-army officer and now very much head of operations and various other security related issues at the Shiv Nadar school, and my good friend Captain Garry Singh, ex-Special Forces officer and now the president of IIRIS. So I'll start with you, Garry. Can you give me a big picture that, in your appreciation and understanding of things, what are the big challenges that we are up against? On the face of it, one thing it appears that educational institutions generally, and I may be making a remark which you could contest, that they are generally blasé. You know, they are thinking, hame kuch nahi hone wala hai. But that is something that I think we need to really step back and look at seriously, because considering what happened at Peshawar in Pakistan, you know, we should not wait for something like this to happen in India before we pull our socks up.
Sure, I think schools as such, moment you talk about schools and students, immediately what you're looking at is future. So if you can't get your schools right overall, you're not getting your future right. Safety and security is one concern which we need to address. And somewhere or the other, in India, we must understand, with all the violence, crime, and psychological pressures these kids go through, these kids require extra attention. So places like USA, Australia, they all have made wonderful standards and principles to operate in schools, whether it's safety, psychological security, anything else. We face more challenges, our kids face more challenges, but we have somewhere or the other left it to the players who are not ready to take the responsibility. In the last 1 or 2 years, people like CBSE, people like NDMA, they have regularly given guidelines. They're talking about how to get even the internet protocols right, safety right, but none of these are becoming bounding. None of these are mandatory. So I think this is high time. The central government comes out with a law and regulation to say, how do we ensure things are all right from safety security perspective at school? Then maybe they can tell state governments to come up with their rules and SOPs. But this is really one time we need to look at how exactly we will ensure our schools are secure, our future is secure.
Well, yeah, you've painted the big picture. And obviously, when you look at statistics, the big picture is not looking a very happy one. I want to stay for a moment in the big picture scenario, which is that safety and security is not just about increasing the height of your boundary walls. It is not just about putting CCTVs, but it is also about sensible use of technologies to preempt and to prepare us so that we can prevent. And now, how would you compare the example of what you have been doing at now Shiv Nadar schools? Earlier you were at the British school, I'm told. How is it that what you were doing, which is different from what others are doing?
So to answer this question, I'd like to divide it into three parts. First is the infrastructure, then the processes and the partnership. So infrastructure, most of the schools in India, are they actually preparing for the safety and security from the beginning when the building is about to be constructed? Or they are just doing the needful as and when the requirement occurs? Mostly the latter is the case. And that's the reason we are facing so many issues. There are certain criteria like surveillance devices, your access control, your private and public area which needs to be defined. You need to have a ramps, you need to have a certain, as you said, the boundary walls and all. These things need to be discussed while the map is planned, not once the building is constructed. Second part is the processes. School have to have a standing operating procedure covering the broad aspect of security. They need to know, they need to do the regular briefing, they have to have a mock drills, they have to have a checklist, they have to have the audits. In that case, they need to take help of the external risk management experts who can come, do the audit, give them the recommendation and tell them how to improve further in the safety and security prospect. Thirdly, the partnership. You have such a good resource, parents. Involve them as part of your safety committee members. For example, if you have a legal expert, you have an ex-army or ex-police officer or a serving police officer, tell them to be part of your committee. Tell them to give you the inputs. Let the students be part of that committee. I mean, we have a survey of the school safety. We've taken a school safety round in our school and the students came up with wonderful ideas. They took a round and they want to have a balance between the freedom and the safety. They don't want to be observed while they are swimming, they are eating, or they are walking around. They said, we need to have our place.
Right.
Simultaneously, you have to give us the safety also without taking away our freedom.
Well, I'll proceed further with the safety point. You know, there's a very interesting survey that was conducted by Child Rights and Youth, CRY. And they said around 80% parents believe that school is the safest place for their children. But then you go for official statistics in India, and official statistics say that some 60,000 children go missing every year from schools across India. Largely, I'm told they are from government schools, which don't have the kind of infrastructure and monitoring ability that private schools are bringing into play. So there is that one aspect. The other aspect which equally is concerned of to me is the National Crime Records Bureau has shown steadily an increase in figures wherein children, cases of crime against children have been increasing. And now we are looking at a figure of 2016, which says more than 1 lakh crimes have been registered against children in schools, which is an increase of 11% over the previous year. So there are two issues. One is that will your child go missing? The other issue is crimes against children within the same school. So how would you, Garry, suggest that we can approach this subject without upsetting the sensitivities of the parents or the child?
That's a great way to look forward what we need to do. First of all, we must understand one portion, that yes, kids, these small little angels, are very, very susceptible because they cannot fight back an adult. They can even injure themselves while running around, forget about somebody going for a purposeful violent or violence or an attack on kids. So they need all the attention. They need more care than whatever we can do for others. And at the same time, while we need to take care of them, we also need to ensure they're not only the physical security is ensured, but the psychological comfort and safety as well, because something which becomes overwhelming for them today, they're going to carry it their whole life. So first portion comes here is technology. Thankfully, technology in the world is so advanced that anything we want to achieve, we want to do analytics, we want to do instant alerts, anything that the schools want to achieve is possible. But it's again coming at a cost. And something which I will say my panelist, Captain Gurmeet, has put up wonderfully well, that while there can be some central guidelines saying these are to be done, but involve all the stakeholders at the school to say, this is how it can be done, this is what money it costs, and a lot of times school are not doing it only because there is money on the table that they're not able to place in. So if parents say, I want my kids to be safe, and they become stakeholders, it's a great partnership to look at. And somewhere or the other, the students should not be forgotten that they are part of it, at least if not the students of class 1, 2, 3, at least the 10th, 11th, and 12th should be part of these discussions to say, are you comfortable with this? And if they are not, they should be explained why this will work, rather than again thrusting on them the way we are putting all the syllabus and education on them.
Very interesting point. And, you know, we're a bit short of time in this part of the episode, but we will like you to explore a little more with your hands-on experience that, you know, to what extent can we depend on technologies? To what extent can we depend on human responses to the problem? And to what extent can we involve not just the parents, but in adult educational institutions or in colleges, to what extent we can involve the student themselves in becoming alert to the challenges? But all that after a break, when we'll come back and explore the subject in a little more detail. Welcome back. We continue to have our two experts with us, and we're looking at safety and security of schools and also educational institutions across India, which is a very important part of our social fabric. Captain Gurmeet. I want to ask you two questions in one. One is, with your experience, to what extent can we rely on technologies to provide us security, not just to monitor outside the school or institution's boundary walls, but also within the institution? Because what happens is that some figures that have come are very disturbing, and which is about violence within schools, crime against children, and even crime against educational teachers and staff, because a lot of government schools have reported, and the teachers have complained there, that they get, you know, they're at the receiving end of very violent students. So how do you use technology to prevent both these things, of somebody lurking with bad intentions across your boundary wall, at the same time some people who are causing you problems because they are a threat within?
So, before we go into the technology part, the reasons why the students are getting so aggressive is, firstly, I feel that the percentage of parents, they do not say no to the child. The child has not learned how to accept the no since beginning. That is the result. I feel that we have to let the child fall, let them fail, let them feel sad so that they understand the meaning of happiness. They have to participate in the sports competition. They need to lose. Once they lose, they understand what is winning, and they have the sportsmanship in that. So in that case, once we do that, we are making the child more stable. Secondly, the role of the counselor. When we talk about these teenagers, they have not been able to use their energy in the positive direction. So the parents and teachers have to play a very important role in that. The quality versus quantity time has to be spent with them. In the growing age, the quality time is very much required. Simultaneously, the quantity time also gives the great value. in the school, the teachers, when they have a homeroom period, when they talk to the students and they ask them, what is your problem? What issues are you facing? They make them comfortable that you come up with the problems which you're facing. Similarly, the parents have to do the same at home. That's how that...
Okay, but what about technology?
Yeah, the technology is that you have, fine, you have a visitor management system online going on, you have the CCTVs which are installed there, but a certain time, the screen time which a child has, that has to be limited. The screen time is basically causing a... is the cause of concern, because kids are more and more into the media and they are looking at the sites which are not supposed to be looked at. And they're getting various ideas from there. So it has to be limited.
Okay. Garry, I mean, you would like to build up on the technology aspect, but also I want to ask you, and which is linked to technology, that how do you prevent terror attacks on educational institutions? The last one that happened in India was at IISc in Bangalore.
That's right.
But we are lucky. We've got away with it.
Right.
But I don't think we can just count on our luck forever.
Yes. So... going to technology as first step, you know, let me talk about what pitfalls use of technology as of now we're facing. Like I said earlier, the technology is so advanced. Anything and everything that school is wanting to achieve by technology, even when all the school kids coming in, there are cameras which can do face analysis and say who's under stress and who's looking more happy. So even if they want to segregate people, oh, he's facing some challenge every day, or he's been the happiest kid and there is something wrong. So even you can start segregating who needs more attention if you're too apprehensive. But at the same time, what schools or across India, what we're doing is, cameras are eyes. We're putting eyes, but we're not connecting them to brain. So most of the cameras are being put up because the local police or some guidelines have told them that you will put a CCTV. So they'll place the CCTV so that if something goes wrong, police can come and say, do you have the recording? Give it to me. I'll start doing analysis.
I agree with this point, because the monitoring, online monitoring is in most of the school is not happening. The concept of the control room is missing.
Yeah.
The monitoring has to happen. You have
well,
to
the biggest challenge with CCTV is actually to monitor the footage, because you know, you keep recording the footage, but you need lots of people,
so
eyes and ears to look at
it. So CCTV right now is fully capable to prevent, to detect, to deter, and even possible to start a response using the system. If there is a particular analysis on CCTV or otherwise which is indicating the kids is in challenge position, and if you find that kid has not come out of washroom for 20 minutes, it can raise an alert to tell the nearest people that look for that kid. So the possibilities are immense, but I think somewhere or the other, one, the lack of awareness and understanding how to use it, and number two, money. That's where the schools are not able to take a step forward. But schools are just not private schools where all these great kids and CCTVs are installed. The maximum people in this country are in government schools. They are in rural schools where the CCTV is not being discussed about, and what they face is not even discussed in the media till now. So we have a much larger problem at hand, and technology is one piece which is there to cover. But I think, like I said initially, the framework. Coming back to terrorist attack, well, no harm in saying no country or no school in this world is ready that they can prevent or handle a terrorist attack. It's a much larger policy issue, international relations and everything involved. But yes, is there a possibility that we can ensure that even if attack happens, the damage is minimized? Yes, we can create far better gate, gun structure and everything else attached to it. And somewhere or the other, the response mechanism of schools being integrated with the law enforcement and other forces which are supposed to be respond to these agencies, that link as of now is missing. So more important than anything else, if this links start working together, the collaboration takes place, I think not only schools, any part of the city, any part of the society or offices can be made much, much smaller.
Yeah, and also the thing is that, you know, if you project an image that you are relatively secure,
yes,
and you are on the ball, I mean, if the David Headley report is an example to go by, you know, terrorists do survey targets, and they tend to go for targets which look vulnerable. But if you give an image of being strong and well fortified, they'll avoid you and they'll probably go to the next target, because they get one chance and they want maximum impact.
Right.
But to go back to a point that you had raised, and you know, about internet, people watching television and how they get impacted. One of the things that is a real problem area, and India has topped the list of 254 countries for cyberbullying, right? And this is furthermore, 32% parents surveyed in India said their children were experiencing cyberbullying, but also there is the problem of the blue whale challenge, which has again led to a number of suicides and a number of cases where people have reflected that, you know, there's no way you can control what's going on in the mind of the child because he or she is getting influenced by things. So we have that, and we also have a problem that, forget schools for a moment, even colleges. They don't have mental health counseling centers. They don't have, because they are seen to be almost adult, people like to leave them apart and they will manage on their own. So the whole focus is only on schools, but educational institutions are educational institutions. So what steps do you suggest?
I see the role of the counselor, which is an important aspect. So, you know, it says the counselor is a psychologist and he or she is not a psychiatrist. Firstly, the kids need to be very, very comfortable approaching the counselor. Secondly, the vigilant part. Forget about the technology. Even in the government school, if people are vigilant, people are observing the students, or in the government colleges, if they are observing the students, they see any unusual behavior, a person is lonely, a person is not mixing around, a person is doing something which in a normal person should not be doing. Mm. Such cases must be reported to the counselor, and the person needs to be make so comfortable that he or she approaches the counselor and shares the problems. And in that case, the parents, teachers, and the students' communication helps each other, and they can help the child. Because, for I'll just share an example.
No, we're really short of time, but we've got your point. Garry, the last question to you, and because you're so widely traveled and you know you're connected to so many parts of major countries in the world, what kind of global standards can Indian schools hope to replicate in terms of security as well as the safety of school children? Just give us some idea.
Sure. So like I was mentioning initially, if you're visiting, so two countries which have done maximum amount of work are Australia and USA in this. Forget about schools. They have even created enough detailed procedures and infrastructure needs for the kids' garden. So if your kid is going to a kids' care even before the school, so they have even worked till that. But will that work for us? Are we ready to just pick it up and say, here is another situation? Not really. The risk which their kids face are very different from what our kids face. So we need to maybe take them as some guideline in case we are happy to start with it, but we need to customize. And somewhere or the other, the solutions are very simple. The only problem is we are not thinking about it. For example, when the cyberbully and everything happens, I want to ask the parents first that how come your son has got or a daughter has got a mobile before the age of 14 when they are not allowed to be on Gmails and Facebooks and everywhere else? And after that, even if you want to give them, why can't you have a monitoring on that? Why are you expecting school to handle? And school can do a simple procedure. Anybody coming to school provides a Wi-Fi network which is monitored, and anything that you do within the space which school is permitting you is fine, but moment you go anywhere outside that, whether it is a pond, it is somewhere where the bullying can take place, it is a place where you should not be, the school can get to know themselves because you're all hooked onto them. Similar thing can be at home. So it's far more easy to control and monitor. I think the challenge here is parents want school to do it, school thinks, parents, you are providing all these gadgets, why I should be responsible for it. So the collaboration doesn't exist, the framework doesn't exist. I will say we all want to do it, but there is nobody ready to take a step forward how to do it.
We're terribly short of time. Thank you very much for your expertise. And we have all learned a lot from the show. We'll be back next week with another episode. Until then.